As an aspiring screenwriter, I often think about one particular question. What is the best screenplay ever written? Which film is the one with the best story, the best characters, the best dialogue, the best themes, pacing, etc.? For a winner, I often go back to master writers like Quentin Tarantino, Billy Wilder, Paul Schrader, or Francis Ford Coppola. They are all masters of their own style and know exactly what it takes to make a truly engaging story on paper that manifests itself onto the screen. However, recently there has been a film ingrained in my head for a while, and I often think about its screenplay in particular and what it did single-handedly to the film industry. I'm of course talking about the screenplay that's high on every best screenplay of all time list, the 1974 neo-noir classic, Chinatown. There is so much to appreciate about this admittedly legendary film. The acting, the direction, the cinematography, even Jerry Goldsmith's earworm-inducing score are all top-notch. However, I, as well as likely most others in the screenwriting community, don't believe that Chinatown would be as legendary as it is if it weren't for Robert Towne's equally legendary screenplay. It's weird. Looking back at Robert Towne, unlike Tarantino or Billy Wilder, doesn't have a distinct style, and he hasn't even written for that many good movies in my opinion. He did write for some classics before Chinatown, Bonnie and Clyde in The Last Detail, yet afterwards, with the exception of Sidney Pollack's Yakuza or The First Mission Impossible, his scripts are kind of devoid of clout, recognition, and quality. Apparently, though, it was enough to get major clout and recognition from news sites at the very least. Vulture, a branch of the New York Times, put him at number 3 for the top 100 screenwriters. Number 3. That's above Tarantino, Coppola, and Schrader. He's definitely done enough to be in the top 10 in my opinion, but more than those guys? I'd argue William Goldman should be higher. My thoughts of his prestige as a writer aside, he did indeed craft what I consider to be the best and most perfect screenplay ever written. Though Pulp Fiction will always be my favorite, in my opinion, Chinatown is as close to perfect as it gets. And today, for my first analysis video, I'm going to be dissecting and determining what makes this screenplay in particular such a masterpiece. I won't be giving any background on how this film as a whole came to be because, one, it was a much bigger hassle than I intended, and two, there's already a great book by Sam Wasson called The Big Goodbye, Chinatown and the Last Years of Hollywood. I highly recommend you check that book out for a more in-depth look at the production. So without further ado, let's get this started. Back in the late 60s to early 70s, film started to, for lack of a better word, take its time. Not to say that film had necessarily gotten dull, far from it. Many legendary films came from that period. The thing is that most big movies from the 40s into probably as late as the early to mid 60s moved much faster than the period that succeeded it. Every edit, performance, transition, and piece of dialogue moved a lot faster, and it was indicative of most films of that period. But starting around 1966, the pace of all that I mentioned was dramatically slowed down for most films of that era. It was a period that died a bit quicker in my opinion, as Star Wars pretty much put the nail in the coffin in 1977. But 1966 through 1977 was certainly an interesting window for slower films. And then there's Chinatown. Where most films in the late 60s to mid 70s were very slow with clunky camera movements, Chinatown stands out by being more similar to the films of the era before it. The tone screams class and elegance in terms of the characters and the way they speak. Most of that can be attributed to the dialogue. Most of Chinatown's lines are written as more of a callback to the films of that era. The snark, the detailed explanations, etc. However, it's almost as if Chinatown is a mix of old and new styles. As for every fast-paced and energetic scene, you have scenes like the one where Jake returns to Evelyn's house, where he delivers maybe the second most iconic line in the entire film, right behind the final line.
What were you doing there?
Working for the district attorney.
Doing what?
As little as possible.
The district attorney gives his men advice like that.
They do in Chinatown.
Every line is kept low and slow, which not only does it make sense, it's also very smart. Those slow moments really allow you to soak up very narratively important and thematically resonant lines such as that. The actors go through this very specific pace throughout the film. Jack Nicholson, who is known for more slow-paced films, seemingly pushes that stigma just a little bit by speeding up his dialogue in very specific ways, yet keeping everything else very Nicholson-like. John Huston is a particularly weird but very clever case. Huston's character uses more wisdom-entailed sentences and phrases, and talks slower than pretty much any other character. What's strange is that John Huston also happens to be the director of some of the most classic films of that fast-paced era. Maltese Falcon, The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, The African Queen, he was sort of a major face of some of the greats. Yet for someone who made films like that and is now in a callback to that era of films, it's crazy how he's the one who speaks the slowest. It speaks to me as a deliberate choice made to cast him or any other icon of that era, someone who's old and tired, doesn't bother to talk that fast anymore. And that sentiment can be directed towards what I like most about the dialogue. The dialogue, for the most part, is very witty, and I always like a witty script, but what makes it truly stand out, which is what I meant when I talked about films of this era taking their time, is Chinatown's blend of those styles. The reason the leisure and clunkiness works is because it makes for a more meaningful and memorable film, and it gives each character a humanistic quality instead of just being, well, characters. Town makes sure to write the dialogue like a real human being would have used to interact with others in real life. He takes every character and every situation into account, writing lines that are rich with complex emotions and personalities. The dialogue also flows through that mix in tone and pace that I mentioned so well. Town made it so that the engaging conversations would not only lull you into the world, but would make you pay attention to the more slow and quiet moments. That's the trick. Give you the heightened scenes of suspense and drama, paving the way where when those scenes break, you're left soaking in the lines of tenderness. Shifting between those dialogue tones is pretty difficult considering you have to know when to break and when to pick back up again, and a lot of that success does come from the direction, but it also comes from Town's ability of when to break those moments of tension. And I think he nailed it, but that's only a portion of this script's power. Now let's talk about the characters. Another reason for the script's undeniable power is the establishment of the characters and their motives. For this category, I'll be mainly talking about the three more or less fleshed out characters of the film, perhaps mentioning other characters along the way. In fact, the majority of this category will be focused on the main protagonist, but the other two definitely are worth mentioning as their strengths are what make them characters that I cannot just passively mention. Usually your average protagonist for this type of story resembles that of an urban knight, taking on more clean-cut tasks. J.J. Gittes is a private investigator that usually takes on more scandalous cases, which means a dubious love affair is an ordinary case for him. J.J. Gittes is the perfect protagonist for this type of story for a number of different factors. Chief among them is what I mentioned in the previous category. Because the film is a mixture of old and new tones, Gittes is a mixture of archetypal heroics and grimy rebels. He's a snarky, passive-aggressive, and wisecracking asshole who isn't afraid to piss people off and take borderline desperate measures to solve a case. However, he is also a man who takes a harsh stance against corruption and tries to be helpful and caring towards the people that hire him. There is one scene early on that perfectly demonstrates his rebellious devotion against corruption. We see Jake getting a shave at a local barber shop after exposing Hollis Mulray's love affair, which was printed out for the city to see. A man sitting next to Gittes in this barber shop starts criticizing Gittes for the publicity of his borderline exploitative expose. When he's confronted by the man hinting at the news piece being scandalous on behalf of Jake's job, he gets up and threatens the man making this accusation, exclaiming,
"Listen, pal, I make an honest living. People only come to me when they're in a desperate situation."
That scene is easily one of the best and most important in the film, as not only as it is paced and performed wonderfully, but his abrasiveness, irony, and defensiveness against corruption is aptly on full display. His interactions towards other characters in this film is another important factor in the script's greatness. His relationships often reflect his mood and the different sides of his personality. Probably two of the biggest examples of his two-sided personality are his relationships with Evelyn Mulray and Police Lieutenant Lou Escobar. Evelyn I shall talk about more in depth in a minute, but in short, Mulray brings out Jake's good nature more or less. Though when he feels he's being deceived by her, his abrasiveness is released. Escobar, on the other hand, Gittes couldn't be more abrasive too. Gittes had worked with the police force and Lou Escobar in Chinatown before he had to deal with corruption, that lay within all of Chinatown and its police division. So naturally, he would tie his hate of corruption to Chinatown and Lou Escobar. Whenever he interacts with Lou, he insults him, antagonizes him. The difference of Gittes' relationship between Lou and Evelyn are night and day, which definitely falls in line with his heroic slash rebellious character. Where things get morally gray is his relationship with Noah Cross. Whereas Jake's interactions with most characters trigger one of two different sides of his personality, Noah seems to trigger a confused mix between the two throughout the entirety of the film. Whenever he encounters Jake, Jake becomes more silent than anything, like he's desperately trying to deduce how to respond to him. It's what makes this story more realistic, more of a mix of that slow period of film. It shows him as a real investigator by nature, and that's what makes him stand out as a phenomenal protagonist. Evelyn Mulray is the wife of the aforementioned Hollis Mulray, chief engineer of the water and power supply for the city of Los Angeles. Whereas Jake as a character is developed by the dialogue and the relationships he shares between the other characters, Evelyn is developed through the mystery and the way her story is tangled in the plot. So obviously I can't talk too much about her, but she is also a great protagonist. She is a very secretive character, yet is the only character who seems to bring out the good in Jake Gittes. Other than having an interesting part in this entire abyss of a mystery, her relationship with Gittes is incredibly interesting and plays off the entire film so well. She's overall the character that makes you the most emotionally invested in the story, and you often feel sympathetic towards her throughout the rest of the film. Noah Cross is the owner of the company that runs the water and power and is revealed to be the father of Evelyn. Noah Cross is a very rich and powerful man who is quite deceiving. At first you don't think much of him when Gittes first meets him, but when Jake slowly starts to peel back the mystery, it's revealed that Noah is behind this conspiracy. Noah is a brilliant villain because of the unexpected true nature of his intention, as well as the embodiment of Chinatown's primary themes and messages. He is someone that hides behind their wealth and power in order to fulfill their greed. These three make up the phenomenal character writing, but the true legendary part of the script is what comes next. Aspect of the script that is pretty much why Chinatown remains one of the most influential and best scripts ever made. For the subject of this part, as it is the most in-depth part of the analysis, I'm going to go through different subtopics, pretty much the three acts of the film, but under surrogate structured titles. The setup is one of the most legendary first acts in film history for a reason. It starts with a woman by the name of Evelyn Mulray, who thinks that her husband is cheating on her, seeing Jake in his office, wanting him to spy on her husband. Reluctantly, Gittes takes the job, and the job is very easily done. This sequence is great because it demonstrates his crafty way of taking on tasks, which will be demonstrated many more times moving forward. After the investigation, we get two very shocking revelations. The first comes when the news articles for Mulray's affair become public. Gittes finds another woman in his office telling him that she is in fact Mrs. Mulray, and threatens a lawsuit for slandering her husband, revealing that Mrs. Mulray that initially came in was a fraud. The second revelation comes when Gittes goes to the reservoir after he investigates Mrs. Mulray at her house, and finds out that Mulray, Hollis Mulray, has been murdered, seemingly strangled and drowned in the reservoir. That is when the real investigation begins. What's great about this setup is the mundane nature of the affair case at the beginning, which hits you with a 1-2 punch of those plot twists. The first being pretty funny, and the second one being quite shocking. What is mundane ends up being a gigantic goof, which that goof ends up being the opening to a giant conspiracy with many different outlying factors. The first 30 minutes is done so perfectly as it gives a sample for the rest of the story, with an effortless transition to the second act. From the revelation of Mulray's death onwards, the second act becomes a series of meticulously placed clues and characters that Jake delves into throughout the course of the investigation. Robert Towne laid the groundwork and now diligently progresses toward a conclusion through a series of conversations, confrontations, and revelations. To me, the investigation involves two separate main aspects that eventually converge back to one all-seeing force that's behind the corruption. The first element of the investigation that is introduced is the more socioeconomical element. In the beginning, Mulray is introduced as the chief engineer of water and power for all of LA. The reservoir, ironically for the time being, seems to be what killed Mulray. For a certain period of time, it's the leading case for Mulray's murder, as we see early on during the setup that Mulray controversially denied building the proposed reservoir in a conference that Gid is eavesdropped on. Like I said, this builds the scope for the situation and stakes of this investigation. This proves to be a decision opposed by the farmers of the outskirts of LA, hilariously punctuated by a farmer herding a flock of sheep, there to criticize and protest Mulray's decision. The outskirts of LA, where the farmers are, also plays a big role in the film as it's used as a cover-up, while also being the main intentions for the villain to take over the water and power supply. It is said that Town had taken this aspect of the film from a real case that happened in LA involving a battle for rights of water in Owens Valley in the early 1920s, aptly named the Water Wars. The meticulousness of this aspect comes from the way the perpetrator had set it up and the clues that Gittes used to come to that accusation, which go hand in hand. This aspect involves a lot of confrontations and conversations between Gittes and each individual directly involved with the investigation, which is why the dialogue and character writing that I talked about in the previous two parts fit beautifully in this story. Not to mention, I earlier stated that both of these aspects are unpredictable in different ways. The unpredictability of this aspect comes from the leads that Gittes conjures up through these clues. Speaking of those clues, who gave Gittes the clue about obituaries, the piece of information that gives Gittes a lead? Speaking of those clues, who gave Gittes the clue about the obituaries, which is the piece of information that gives Gittes his first lead? That's where Ida Sessions comes in, who is a woman that initially pretended to be Mrs. Mulray. Ida Sessions is a great character that I didn't mention in the second part of this analysis. She is a great character because of her mysterious nature and her contribution to the investigation. The second aspect of the mystery at first seems to be completely uninvolved with the socio-economical part of the mystery, which is supposedly the main mystery. But it has to do with Evelyn Mulray, who's the subject of the more emotional aspects of the mystery. From the reveal of Mulray's death, it becomes apparent that Evelyn is secretive of something else. She's what ultimately makes the viewer emotionally engaged in the story because of her backstory, being slowly revealed as the film progresses towards its conclusion. What is also great about the aspect of the mystery is that it is basically a meter of progression throughout the film, as the political aspects and the emotional aspects slowly come back to the source of the situation. Yet the theme of unpredictability isn't lost because it comes from the fact that it seemingly doesn't even relate to the investigation in the first place. The fact that these aspects being cut from the same cloth slowly comes to fruition as the story progresses. And that makes sense given that Evelyn is the only character in the entire story that brings out that good nature. This does a really great job keeping that mix of film-era tones consistent as well. The romance is very similar to noir classics a la Maltese Falcon or Laura, yet on the other side of the coin you have the political scheme reminiscent of films of the slow era of cinema a la All the President's Men or Z. These two aspects mesh together seamlessly. Town connects these two elements together through the character of Hollis Mulray. His elusiveness is what adds a layer of mystery to the whole story. You get one brief scene with him and it already tells you a good deal about the character and you immediately believe that something bad could happen to him. His elusiveness is what adds a layer of ambiguity to the whole story. The entire story is phenomenal, but the ending is the specific pinpoint of Chinatown's legendary status. It gets revealed that Noah Cross was both behind Hollis Mulray's murder, the scheme used to recover his power of the water ducks, and is revealed to be Evelyn's father, and even bore a child with her. This is the point of the film at its most simplistic, as every element comes to a head, and the only thing left is to try and invoke justice for Evelyn and against Noah Cross. All the major characters eventually end up in Chinatown, where Evelyn, armed and sights aimed towards Noah, gathers all her belongings and gets in the car. But the tragic ending was foreshadowed even before its final scene. Gittes decides to confront Cross for all of his actions. However, Cross strikes back by telling Jake that there is no hope for him in terms of bringing Cross to justice. And he was right. During that final scene, Cross even points out again that he has power and he can't be stopped. The way he said it wasn't even that subtle. Nonetheless, Evelyn tries to speed away and ultimately pays the price. He was shot cleanly in the head in a brutal sequence that is pretty hard to watch. With that, Cross has Evelyn's daughter in his possession and the corruption remains in full power. Gittes, about to be arrested by Escobar, mutters that same line he said to Evelyn in reference to Chinatown. Afterwards, Escobar shows Gittes mercy by letting him go home, but before he can turn back to Lou, his associate caps off the film with possibly cinema's most iconic final line.
Forget it, Jake. It's Chinatown.
It's the cherry on top of the sundae and a moment that lets viewers at ease in the same way as Jake is after a brutal finale. It's a genius third act that perfectly caps off the themes of the film. When I first watched this movie, I didn't like it that much. It was a good movie, but I found it boring in some parts. Now, I think it's one of the greatest things ever made, and the screenplay is what particularly caught my eye. The fact that I was able to make a 22-minute analysis goes to show just how legendary it is. It is a timeless masterpiece that is certainly never boring and always gives an aspiring screenwriter something to dig into. The reason I call it perfect is because it's the most well-rounded screenplay where every element works off of each other so seamlessly. There are screenplays I enjoy more, like Pulp Fiction, in fact probably just Pulp Fiction, but this screenplay has done so much to influence screenwriters that it's enough to crown it as the greatest screenplay ever written. I want to thank every single person who came to my channel to watch my Chinatown analysis. This was a blast to make, and I have more planned for the future for this channel. I want to give a big shout out to Taco Movie Talks. He is a very respectful, kind guy who inspired me to channel my passion for film and was the driving force for me to start making YouTube videos. And that's it. Thank you very much for watching. Please exit this video more invested in the world of film, and goodbye.